Alhamdulillah, on behalf of the organizers, I'd like to welcome all of you to this, a series of 8 lessons in the Seerah of the Blessed Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, the one that we have been informed inside the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ, that verily in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best of examples.
Subhanallah.
The best of examples. لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ, for the one who hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ, and hopes in the last day, وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا, and the one who remembers Allah much. If we intend to follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam as Muslims, we must have knowledge of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever an individual wishes to do the following, the ittiba', the following, and place a person as an example to be followed, and he wishes to follow that person, he needs to have knowledge in order for him to follow that person. For without knowledge, he will not know how that person acted, how that person behaved, how that person solved various issues that arose within that person's life. So we find that when people follow different people inside this world, they gain knowledge regarding them. Then they begin to act like them. Then they begin to speak like them. And then they use them as reference points within their lives. The reference for a Muslim inside his life, in solving problems, in the way that he behaves, in the way that he speaks, in the way that he deals with all aspects of this life, is none other than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And in these lessons, what I hope to do in this lesson and the 7 after this, is to take you through that journey which is known as the Seerah, the journey of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he traversed in the outward aspect of this life for 63 years on the surface of this earth, and left the greatest of examples for mankind until he was veiled from this world. What I will attempt to do is take us through the major events that unfolded in the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that we create inside ourselves a framework for further reading, further investigation, and further tahqiq, actualization of the details of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For 8 lessons of 1.5 length, hour length each, are not sufficient to encompass that great life and the very many aspects of that life that a Muslim needs to know about. But insha'Allah ta'ala, hopefully these lessons will build a kind of framework for you all to go away and say, I need to learn more about this aspect of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this aspect of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But I have in my mind a framework of the journey that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam undertook inside this world, and some of its major events. The basis of this course will be the work of Sayyid Muhammad ibn Alawi al-Maliki al-Makki rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, which is this work, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of creation, a glimpse of his blessed life. I will be dipping in and out of the book, and the book is a great book for each one of you to have as well as part of their reading as well. I will focus mainly on the second part of the book, which is part 2, which is a chronology of the main events during his era. Again, 8 lessons, I won't be able to cover every single event that he's mentioned, even though his work is a very concise work detailing the major events in the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there are many events in here that we will not be able to cover because of the time, time restrictions. What we will do is pick out the most major in each year of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and try and take some detail regarding them, rather than touch upon every single event and not really understand any major significance of each particular event. And the fact that if we were to take all the events, we would not be able to give any detail surrounding those events properly for them to stick in our minds and for us to understand the reality of those events. Apart from this work also, I will be referring to this work, which is Siratul Mustafa in the Urdu language, but it's been translated into the English language. It's the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of Islam, by Allama Abdul Mustafa al-A'zami rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, and he was a student of the great student of Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, Sadr al-Sharia Mawlana Amjad Ali al-A'zami rahmatullahi ta'ala, he is one of his students. This is a much more detailed work. Sayyid Muhammad in his work rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi has brought a concise chronology of the events in the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this goes into a lot more detail. So this is like for further reading as well. And I will touch upon points in both of those works, and sometimes I'll refer to points that are extracted from the source books of the Seerah from the early generations. So those are some works that you can look at inside in the English language. What is Seerah? What is Seerah? This word that we hear often, the Seerah of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Linguistically, the scholars say that Seerah has a number of meanings. From them is the meaning of a sunnah, in the meaning of a trodden path. A pathway that is walked upon. A trodden path, a sunnah. It can also have the meaning of tariqah, in the meaning of a manner of doing something. That Seerah is a manner of doing something in language. It can also have the meaning of al-hay'ah, and hay'ah would mean the appearance of something. These meanings, you can see that they are touching upon each other, and there is a kind of shared meaning inside them. The path which is trodden upon, the way that is taken, the manner of doing something, the appearance of someone in doing something. And the scholars say that it can be the hala, it can be the state of a person. So if we look at these meanings, a pathway, a manner of doing something, a trodden path, the appearance of someone in doing something, or the way of acting, the state of conduct, we can see that Seerah is relating to what? The biography effectively of a person. His adab, his akhlaq, his manners, his morals, his way of acting, his way of dealing with things. How he treads through this life, how he traverses through his life, and the example that he leaves. And when the word Seerah is used, we know that that means the Seerah, the life, the biography of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Seerah, we can understand, is going to detail the life, the actions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the 63 years that he spent on the surface of this earth before he was veiled from us, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Its importances are many. The Quran has informed us that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of examples. How will we know the example that he set and he left for us unless we have learned something about his life? That we know what he did when he was young. What did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam do when he proclaimed prophethood? And what did he do inside the Meccan phase of his da'wah? And what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam do inside the Medinan phase of his da'wah? How did he deal with people? How did he deal with his wives? Ridwanullahi radiyallahu ta'ala anhunna. How did he deal with the Sahaba ikiram ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in? Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. How did he deal with nations? All of these things we can never understand. And we can never take the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an example in those things unless we learn about his life. So it is incumbent upon the believer that he doesn't exit this world except that he has read about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this should be a target for us and our children, that we do not allow our children to leave this world except that they have read something about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if it be a brief work about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And ourselves as well, we should aim that we do not leave this world except that we have studied in some form, in some way, whether it's through reading, attending classes, that we do not leave this world except that we have become acquainted with the life of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are informed in the Quran also that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us in Surah Al-Fath verses 8 and 9, Inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadhira. Surely we have sent you as a witness, present and seeing, and a bearer of glad tidings and a warner. لِتُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ. So that you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you believe in his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ. These pronouns are returning back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that, O people, you may believe in Allah and his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you may respect him and honor him, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَتُسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. And that you may glorify Allah in the morning and the evening. We are told that the purpose, one of the purposes of the sending of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that he has been sent as a witness over mankind, a bearer of glad tidings, has been sent as a warner, so that we may believe in Allah. The way we have ma'rifah, the way we have knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way we gain knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through the messengers alayhim salam. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last and final messenger to all mankind. We have been informed that we may believe in Allah, that we believe in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that we may respect and honor him. The question is, how does one respect and honor any individual? By knowing about him. by having love for him. How does one create love for the greatest of creation, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that he honors and respects him? Well, if a person does not know about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he can still love him. He can hear some details about him, that he is the last and final Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He will intercede for us, the Ummah, on the Day of Judgment. In fact, he will have a shafa'atul uzma, in which he will intercede for all of creation, in the meaning that he will release them from the weight prior to the accounting. The weight where people will sweat to the extent that some people will drown in their sweat. The only person that from creation that will be able to release them from that is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he implores in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that will avail all of creation in the meaning of release from the weight. As we know, no disbeliever will enter into Jannah. The specific shafa of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in relation to releasing people from the fire into Jannah is in relation to his ummah. So a person may know of these details, and that will create love of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside him. But that love will reach another level when he begins to learn about the struggles of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The way the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered the da'wah, the struggles, the difficulties that he encountered inside Mecca. What happened to him inside Ta'if? What happened to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the phase of Medina? And what happened to the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alaihi wasallam prior to him leaving this world? And how was the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the last moments of his life? All of these things will increase the love of a person, connect him to the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alaihi wasallam, and that is a source of salvation in this world, and it is a source of salvation in the Akhirah. For in the Akhirah, when everyone will flee from the other, when brother will flee from brother, wife will flee from her husband, a child will flee from their parents, and vice versa. But the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be saying, "Ummati, ummati, my nation, my nation." Thus it is incumbent upon us that we learn about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, learning about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives us context for the Quran. For the Quran was revealed over 23 years of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was revealed at that time in certain contexts. And obviously, we know the general rule that where an ayah is revealed and there is nothing to restrict the ayah, then it is taken in its general meaning. Thus we find that Islam in its principles and its the ayat of the Quran are applicable for every time and every place. But knowing about the context of the revelations, of the revelation of the ayat of the Quran, knowing the realities in which the ayat were revealed, helps a person understand. Especially for the ulama, at the level of the ulama, where they will look at the asbab al-nuzul, the circumstances surrounding the revelation of the verses. But if our children knew the reality of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the actions that he conducted inside his life, I am willing to say with a kind of like, even to say to the extent that take an oath by Allah, even that would be a great barrier between our children and what people claim is extremism. For knowing what the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam did in his life, knowing the contexts of actions of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam, is a barrier from being extreme, falling into extremism, either falling short or going to the other extreme. All of these things that are emerging in our time, where there are certain voices saying that within the Muslim communities there is extremism, whether it be voices from outside of the community or from within the community, and there are attempts to solve these problems. The government arranges programs, the communities arrange programs. By Allah, if we taught the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam correctly and taught the contexts of the actions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have neither need for this prevent or that prevent. The greatest preventative from falling into wrong is the blessed example of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alaihi wasallam. So we are in need of the seerah. Our children are in need of the seerah in order to inculcate love and understanding of the actions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, in the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see the actions of the sahaba ridwanullahi alaihim ajma'in in relation to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How did they behave with him? How did they react with him? What was the revolution people underwent from wanting to kill the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to loving him more than they loved everything in this world? How did that occur? How did that happen? In other words, we learn from the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in how one should love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That is part of the seerah. For the seerah involves the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam amongst the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. That is the context. Him teaching the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, him teaching all of mankind. And the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Alayhim Ajma'een remaining as the best of examples, that first generation, the early generation. In the hadith of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, narrated by Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. None of you truly believe. Iman is not perfected. Iman is not kamil, complete, unless you love me more than you love your parents, love your children, and all of mankind. How do we breed that? How do we breed that inside ourselves and inside our children? Unless we learn about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Unless we journey through that journey that Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam took inside this world, we try to feel the pain that the Sahaba ridwanullahi alaihim ajma'in felt when they saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, various circumstances in his life. That we try to even feel the pain of the Sahaba kiram ridwanullahi alaihim ajma'in when they underwent different persecutions in order to uplift the Messenger of Islam, in order to protect the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We see how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with different types of people. His mercy and compassion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His being a leader of the people. His being a husband with a wife. His being a father with children. All of these aspects of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we cannot truly understand them unless we learn about his life. And when we learn about his life, we begin to love him to a higher degree. A more perfect love. A more deeper love than just knowing some details, some aspects of his life. But when we learn about specific events in his life and how he reacted to specific events and what was done to him and how the Sahaba were around him, this will deepen our love for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. In a further hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, a man came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, كَيْفَ تَقُولُ فِي رَجُلٍ أَحَبَّ قَوْمًا وَلَمْ يَلْحَقْ بِهِمْ. O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do you say about a man? He loves a group of people, but he has yet to meet them. He loves a group of people, but he has not met those people. So look, even though a person has not met a group of people, he may still have love. He may still have a love for that person. That love will increase what? With knowledge about that person. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. A man will be with the one that he loves. Thus, if our love is true and the love of our children is true, we will be with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the Day of Judgment. They too, when we will be unable to help them, our children, you can help them in this world as much as you like, in the outward, feed them, clothe them and so forth. But if you do not look after their soul, if you do not do rectification of the soul and the tarbiyah of the inner self and do not connect them with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you have not helped them. For on the Day of Judgment, when no one will help anyone from the creation, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be searching for his ummah. So connect your children to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Connect yourselves to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, the hadith of the man in Sahih al-Bukhari who asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that when will be the hour? And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him that what have you prepared for it? Ma a'adatta lahu. What have you prepared for it? And he informed the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that apart from the obligatory deeds, I have not done many supererogatory deeds. I have not fasted a lot beyond that which is obligatory, or prayed a lot beyond the obligatory, or given sadaqah beyond that which is the obligatory, the zakah. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him all of this and said to him, walakinni uhibbu Allah wa rasulah. But I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I love his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Anta ma'a man ahbabt. You are with the ones that you love. You are with the one that you love. Therefore we need to breed this love of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's a great bishara, a great glad tidings for the one who loves the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith of the Sahih Imam Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Min ashaddi ummati li hubban nasun yakununa ba'di. يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ لَوْ رَآنِي بِأَهْلِهِ وَمَالِهِ. From the most intense of my ummah in love for me. From the most intense of my ummah in love for me. A group of people, يَكُونُونَ بَعْدِي, they will be after my time. يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ لَوْ رَآنِي بِأَهْلِهِ وَمَالِهِ. One of them will want to see me even if it meant sacrificing his family and his wealth in order to do that. We should all want to be part of this hadith. We should all want and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That someone would be prepared to sacrifice everything they have, in order that they have one glimpse of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. We can never reach the love of the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is a group of people that have passed, and that is a group of people that had company with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether it was a year or many years, or whether it was a month, or whether it was a day, or whether it was for fleeting moments, they have attained a rank that none of us can ever achieve. And none of the successive generations of the Ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can achieve. However, we can try to follow in their footsteps in loving the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So I hope that our journey through the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam will be a cause of us reaching higher levels in love and following of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For if one loves someone, he follows him. If one loves someone, he follows him. That is why you find the people who love people of this world, they try to act like them, they try to dress like them, they try to speak like them. They know that the details regarding them. Thus our children know the details of the players and the substitutes of a particular football team in such great detail that they know something about the life of those people as well, and which clubs they played in and so on and so forth, but they know nothing about the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet they know nothing about the children of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yet they know hardly anything about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to make great niyas in regards to this. Mentioning a narration that is found inside Ash-Shifa بتعريف حقوق المصطفى of Imam Qadi Iyad rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh. He narrates from Imam Abu Qasim al-Qushayri rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh that there was an individual called Amr ibn Layth. Amr ibn al-Layth. Ash-Shifa' بتعريف حقوق المصطفى is a great work that is also inside the English language that we should try to read. It's available inside the English language, which talks about the rights of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon his ummah. It talks about the early generations as well and the examples of how they loved, followed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is a work that each and every one of us should try and have inside our homes. So he mentions regarding an individual called Amr ibn Layth. He was one of the Muluk of Khurasan, one of the kings of Khurasan, that land which is now Central Asia. And he was known for his bravery. He was seen in a dream after his death, and it was said to him, "Ma fa'alallahu bik? How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treat you?" And he replied, "Ghafara li, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave me my sins." He was asked, "Bimada, for what action, what thing were you forgiven your sins?" Listen to his reply. He said, "Sa'idtu dhirwata jabalin yawman. I climbed to the peak of a mountain one day. Fa'ashraftu ala junudi. I looked down upon my army, my soldiers. Fa'ajabatni kathratuhum. Their multitude and their number, it pleased me when I looked at them. فتمنيت أني حضرت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فعانته ونصرته فشكر الله لي ذلك وغفر لي." He says, "I looked at my army and I said to myself, and I thought to myself, that if only I were at the time of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and I were in his presence, that I could place this army in his service, that I could help him, and I could give him victory through these people." And he didn't live at the time of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he made this great niyyah, this great intention, and this sincere, khalis, pure intention regarding the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded for me for that intention, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave me my sins. So we see the a niyyah related to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at the magnitude of it in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Mullah Ali Qari rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, one of the Huffaz of Hadith, he says this forgiveness is connected to what? The perfection of his niyyah, meaning the purity of his niyyah, the sincerity of his niyyah related to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was forgiven for this. We should teach our children then about the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for this is the way of the early generations. It is narrated from Sayyidina Ali Zainul Abidin, the one that is famously known as Zainul Abidin, Sayyidina Ali ibn al-Husayn radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, Sayyidina Ali, the son of Imam Husayn, who is the grandson of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He narrates, "Kunna nu'allamu maghaziya an-nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa sarayahu kama nu'allamu as-surata min al-Qur'an." Listen carefully. We used to be taught the maghazi, the battle expeditions in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam physically took part. And we used to be taught the expeditions which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent forth, but he didn't physically take part himself. The way that we used to be taught a surah from the Qur'an. We used to be taught the way we used to be taught a surah from the Quran. This is how the early generations brought up their children. Maghazi here means the battles, because we will see that much of the Medinan phase of the da'wah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Medinan phase of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people were trying to eliminate the message of Islam. Thus the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in constant struggle. And there was expedition after expedition, as we will see unfolding in the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And maghazi would be the term that the early scholars used regarding the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The maghazi and the saraya, the battle expeditions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But look how the early generations used to teach it to their children. How many of us try to learn stories about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the sahaba ikram ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'een and read them to our children? In many households, before a child sleeps, stories are read to him. How many of us try to learn a story about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so a child sleeps thinking about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? A child sleeps yearning for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is something we need to think about. This was the way of the early generations. Also, Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the al-ashratul mubashara, one of the 10 guaranteed paradise in a particular narration of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his son, Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Sa'd radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates, كان أبي يعلمنا مغازي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويعدها علينا وسراياه. Our father, Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he says, this is his son. He says, our father, Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, the companion of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين, used to teach us about the battles of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he would enumerate them to us. Such and such a battle, and such a thing happened inside it. He would also tell us about the battle expeditions he sent forth, but he didn't physically take part, which are called saraya, as we will learn. وَيَقُولُ يَا بَنِيَّ هَذِهِ مَآثِرُ آبَائِكُمْ. He would say, my children, these are the traces and the memorable deeds of your forefathers. فَلَا تُضَيِّعُوا ذِكْرَهَا. Do not cause their remembrance to be lost. Do not cause their remembrance to be lost. They are not our physical fathers, biologically, the Sahaba ikram ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'een, but they are our spiritual fathers. They are the fathers of our souls, because through their examples we see a mirror of the actions of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and through their statements we see what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through them relating the statements of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam led his life. Through the description of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his outward appearance was like. Through them relating what happened in life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have an opportunity to connect. And we cannot reach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam except through them. It's through love of the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'een and acceptance of them, and looking at their lives and how they related regarding the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we learn more about the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So it is important we see how the early generations, they stressed the seerah upon their children. Thus we too should be people that stress this upon our children also. I wanted to start today into our journey. So part introduction and part of it actually entering into the actual seerah, life of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. But before we go into the actual life itself, the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the years that which unfolded, we need to know a bit of a background regarding the world into which the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam emerged. The scholars of Islam, inside their works, they speak about the state of the Arabian Peninsula and the state of the world before the emergence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we look at the geography of the Middle East, we find that the Middle East is in the center, effectively, of the world. From which perspective? That we find Europe on one side, we find Asia on one side, we find Africa one side as well. Why do you think the Middle East is called the Middle East? It's in a central, aspect in terms of the continents of this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His divine wisdom, chose that the last and final Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would emerge inside that region, and then His message would be taken to the entire world. If we look at the time of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, prior to His emergence into this world, who were the major, what we call, superpowers of this world? Who had dominion on this earth in the outward form? Towards the northeastern region was the Sasanian Empire, what we know as the Persian Empire. And the Persians mostly were worshippers of fire, the Majus, fire worshippers. And towards the western hemisphere, what we know as Europe, and also the lands of Asham, what we know as Sham today, Syria, Palestine, Jordan, all of these lands in that region, these lands were under the rulership of the Romans who had adopted Christianity. And they were called the Byzantines or the Byzantines. This empire was then founded upon, at that point in time, upon Christianity. Remember, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emerged into this world something like 570 or 571 years after the raising of Sayyidina Isa alayhi wa sallam alive into the heavens. As we know, Sayyidina Isa alayhi wa sallam will return at the end of time and he will rule the ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will kill Ad-Dajjal and then he will pass away, and according to some narrations he will be buried in the proximity of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is, those were the two major powers. In terms of Arabia itself was never taken over by the Romans or the Persians. And some of the historians, they mention perhaps a reason for this is that it was so unruly. There was tribal warfare all the time. There weren't a lot of physical resources at that time inside Arabia. We didn't have oil. That was much later, the discovery, as we know. So outwardly, there wasn't much, didn't see much inside Arabia in the outward terms. And the people were unruly, tribal conflict all the time. Therefore, both empires would position people inside Arabia that would govern regions on their behalf. They would have loyalty to either the Persians or they would have loyalty towards the Roman Empire, the Byzantine Empire. Yemen itself, which is on the southern tip of the Arabian Peninsula, Christianity entered into that region from Abyssinia. Christianity entered into that region from Abyssinia. And the Abyssinians generally were upon Christianity. So we had in the northeast, the Persian Empire. We had in the western aspect, inside Europe, and also toward the northwest, towards the lands of Asham, we had the Byzantines. In the south, inside Yemen, we had pockets of Christians as well. And inside Abyssinia, in the African continent, what is known as Ethiopia today, Habasha in the Arabic language, we had Christians. There were also some Jews inside the Arabian Peninsula. There were Jews inside what we now know as al-Madinah al-Munawwarah. And historically, it was called Yathrib, though we are forbidden to call it ourselves Yathrib. Historically, it was called that. We call it al-Madinah al-Munawwarah. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered al-Madinah al-Munawwarah, it became the illuminated city of Medina. And that is the term that we use, and we are not allowed to call it that term. That is something historical, that it was known by that. There were Jews inside that. There were also some Christians dotted in different places inside the Arabian Peninsula. According to Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi ta'ala in Al-Khasais Al-Kubra, there is a narration regarding an individual that was following the remnants of the teachings of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, and this individual's name was Isa with a sad, Isa, and he built a monastery on the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah. If we look at this, why would someone following the remnants of the teachings of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam journey all the way from Asham, the lands of Palestine, from Bayt al-Muqaddas, and disperse and come and settle inside the Arabian Peninsula? Why would there be Jews inside Medina al-Munawwara before the emergence of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This was because in the previous revelation, in the prophecies of the prophets that have passed alayhi salam, there was mention of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there was description about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there was description of where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would emerge. In fact, there was description of where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would migrate. That is why there were Jews and Christians dotted around the Arabian Peninsula awaiting the emergence of the last and final Prophet, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi in Al-Khasais Al-Kubra narrates a narration in which this individual called Isa, he would continuously inform the Quraysh that a Prophet will be born from amongst you people. And he would be always on the lookout for the emergence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and others in the Arabian Peninsula, as we will learn when we speak about the Seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, maintained belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they too, some of them had knowledge about the scriptures that were with the Jews and the Christians, and they too were searching for the last and final Prophet, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This in brief was a basic geography of and political situation of the world when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emerged. I told you that the Byzantines were followers of Christianity, and the Persians were worshippers of fire. Then you had Christians in the south, inside Yemen as well, inside Abyssinia. What did the Arabs worship? This is interesting because idol worship was not the norm for the Arabs. Though when we learn about historically the Arabs, we have this imagination that they always worship idols. But if we go back to the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his lineage is descended from Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, the son of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam left his blessed wife Sayyidina Hajar radiallahu ta'ala anha and his blessed son Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam inside that region that would become al-Makkah al-Mukarramah, where Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam will be commanded to build the Kaaba, Baytullah. The Kaaba that would be the place of migration and will be the place of circumambulation for the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, with the teachings of Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam inside that region, people were monotheists. They believed in Allah. Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam was present amongst them as a living example, as one teaching the teachings of Tawheed, as all the Prophets alayhi salam, their aqaid are one, their beliefs are one. The differences are inside the rulings. The rulings are related to actions, that in certain sharias of the past, certain things were allowed or not allowed, and later sharias, either they affirmed them and confirmed those rulings, or the rulings were abrogated. And the last and final revelation is with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his sharia is dominant over all that which came before. So when did the Arabs leave monotheism and enter into this polytheism, this worship of idols? The scholars say that inside the Arabian Peninsula, the people that were dominant inside al-Makkah al-Mukarramah, because at that time when Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam was left in the desert with Sayyidina Hajar radiallahu ta'ala anha by Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there was not a populated region called al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. In fact, there was nothing there. It was through the great miracle which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed on Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, the Zamzam gushed forth, and there were individuals from a tribe called the Jurhum. And this tribe Jurhum, they emanate from Yemen originally. Then they moved into the rest of the Arabian Peninsula, and they saw this. They saw signs of water. They saw birds coming together, and signs that there was something there. There was water there. They sent someone forth, and he found there was a spring, Zamzam. And then they began to take permission to live there, and they were given permission by Sayyidina Hajar radiallahu ta'ala anha, Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, to share in the water, but it would stay in the control of Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam and his blessed mother radiallahu ta'ala anha. So the people were upon Tawheed at that time through the teachings of Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, until Jurhum was ousted from al-Makkah al-Mukarramah by Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i. Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i from the Khuza'a tribe of the Arabs. He entered into al-Makkah al-Mukarramah and he expelled Jurhum. When Jurhum left, what they did is they hid the treasure of the Kaaba. And what they did with the Zamzam is they sealed it up so that it couldn't be found. They sealed it up so that it couldn't be found. And they left al-Makkah al-Mukarramah having been defeated in that way. This individual is notorious for bringing idol worship into the Arabian Peninsula. Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i. It is said that he was unwell, ill, and he made a journey towards Balqa in the land of Asham. Balqa in the land of Asham. And there were some hot springs. It was said that he would gain a cure for them from those hot springs. So he cured himself by going there, and he used that as a cure. He saw people worshipping idols. He asked the people, what are these things that you're worshipping? They said, these are things we worship beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa li'adhu billah, and we gain benefit. They claimed we gain benefit from them. And he unfortunately became the first person to bring an idol into al-Makkah al-Mukarramah by taking from them the idol Hubal. He took the idol Hubal from them and he transported it to al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. And because he was the leader of the people and he was such a person that the people, they would follow whatever he did. So he was a person, if he left an example, a bad one, they would follow it. When they saw him doing this, they began to also, the people of Makkah, slowly involve themselves inside idol worship. But the original, prior to that, what were they upon? They were upon Tawheed, on time of Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam. So now we see a move from Tawheed into Shirk, worship of idols. Then it spread from Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. So you can imagine the wretchedness of this individual. That he is the one that brought an idol into Makkah, placed it near the Kaaba. Then he was also the individual who was the cause of the spread of idol worship inside the Arabian Peninsula. People would come to Makkah, obviously, and they would perform the rites that they had, that had been passed down from the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, that what they could remember, the second mambulation of the Kaaba and so forth, some of those actions remained. And they would honor the Kaaba. And then they saw these idols. Then they became embroiled inside idol worship. Idols were made and they were transported into different parts, into the lands of Ta'if and different areas, different idols. Lat, Manat, Uzza, all these idols then emerged inside the Arabian Peninsula.
How many centuries before the
Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I don't recall, but maybe that's a thing I can check and mention to you, inshaAllah ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does mention regarding this individual in some narrations that he saw him dragging his intestines inside the fire. Amr ibn Wahy al-Khuza'i, dragging his intestines inside the fire of hell. Left a very wretched example for the people of Mecca and the people of the Arabian Peninsula. This was the state of things then, that Khuza'a were in charge of Mecca for a long period of time. Until the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Qusay. And Sayyidina Qusay radiallahu ta'ala anhu was approximately 170 years before the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Qusay radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was the grandfather of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, approximately 170 years before the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Briefly mentioning the names in the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so we can picture what we're going to mention now. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the son of Sayyidina Abdullah, who is the son of Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, who is the son of Hashim. And Hashim is the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after which Banu Hashim are known. The clan within the tribe of Quraysh, Banu Hashim, Banu meaning the children, that is they take their name from this individual, from the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his great grandfather. Hashim in turn was the son of Sayyidina Abdul Manaf, who was the son of Sayyidina Qusay. So we're going to speak about Sayyidina Qusay in a moment. Just to mention, Sayyidina Qusay was the son of Kilab. Sayyidina Kilab was the son of Sayyidina Murrah. Sayyidina Murrah was the son of Sayyidina Ka'b. Sayyidina Ka'b was the son of Sayyidina Lu'ay. Sayyidina Lu'ay was the son of Sayyidina Ghalib. Sayyidina Ghalib was the son of Sayyidina Fihr. Why I'm mentioning Sayyidina, I will explain as well, our masters. Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. This individual known as Fihr, Sayyidina Ghalib, the son of Sayyidina Fihr, who in turn was the son of Sayyidina Malik. This Fihr is the one that got the title Quraysh. This individual was the one that was called Quraysh. Different narrations, many different narrations or reasonings the ulama give for the naming of him Quraysh. One of the common ones that scholars mention is that Quraysh is indicating to a large carnivorous animal of the sea, which could be an indication to a shark. And because a shark is brave, a shark is feared and respected, he was respected and he was brave and he got that title Quraysh. That's one of the reasonings. He in turn was the son of Sayyidina Malik, the son of Nadr, the son of Kinana, the son of Khuzaymah, the son of Mudrika, the son of Ilyas, the son of Mudr, the son of Nizar, the son of Ma'ad, which is the best, most correct pronunciation, with the Shadda on the Dal, Ma'ad. And then some books say Ma'ad. Ma'ad, and the son of Adnan. And here we stop, because the scholars say the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't mention every single name all the way back to Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, and in turn back to Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, back to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Therefore we stop where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to stop. In fact, Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala disliked it, that anyone should discuss beyond Sayyidina Adnan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that who were the specific figures, though some of the genealogists did try to attempt to extract, and their opinions differ. There's difference amongst their opinions. Therefore, the safest is to stay with what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. We stay with that. And up to Sayyidina Adnan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, we know the forefathers of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was Sayyidina Qusay, who was 170 years, born approximately 170 years before the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the one that he married into one of the leading families
of the Khuza'a inside Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah, and he eventually became, through that marriage, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained that he would become the person that would become the custodian of the Kaaba. He would become the custodian of the Kaaba, he would become the leader of the people of Makkah al-Mukarramah, he would be the person that was responsible for the Hujjaj, the people that would come and perform pilgrimage inside Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. He formalized Quraysh. Though Quraysh is the name of Sayyidina Fihr radiallahu ta'ala, who, as we mentioned, Sayyidina Qusay is the one who actually formalized the tribe, meaning organized it. In which way? He organized its social aspects, he organized its ruling aspects, he organized the Hujjaj, he formed what is known as Darun Nadwa, which we will mention again inside the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Darun Nadwa was the place, the house of assembly, where the Quraysh would then in his time gather and they would make decisions. The prominent people of Quraysh would gather inside the house of assembly, Darun Nadwa, and make decisions. He was the one who formalized that. So he was responsible for the organization of Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. And then through him descended the different forefathers of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So we see how the forefathers of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, approximately 170 years or 100 and so years before the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they became in control of the rulership of, or the organization of, Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah and prominence inside Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. If we then look at a few of his grandfathers, apart from Sayyidina Fihr and Sayyidina Qusay, Sayyidina Hashim we've mentioned, how did he get that name? Because his name wasn't Hashim. His name was originally Sayyidina Amr. How did he get the name Hashim? They said that he was so generous and he looked after the Hujjaj that at one time there was difficulty and food was scarce and there were difficulties in Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. He went to Ash-Sham. We are told in the Quran, رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ, regarding Quraysh, Surah Al-Quraysh, that they used to undertake the journeys of the winter and the summer. The journey down south to Yemen, and the journey north to Ash-Sham, trading. Sayyidina Hashim, it is mentioned, Sayyidina Amr, whose name became Sayyidina Hashim, radiallahu ta'ala, who made the journey to Ash-Sham. And he brought back bread. He brought back bread and he crushed that bread into the soup. And he broke it. And that action of breaking it, he took his name from it and became called Hashim, the one who breaks the bread or separates the bread and crushes the bread. And he fed this to the Hujjaj, and it became a tradition that the Hujjaj would not be only given soup, but they would be given bread inside the soup. Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather. So Sayyidina Hashim was the great grandfather. Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib was the grandfather of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. How did he receive this name? The slave of Muttalib. When his name was Shayba, his actual name was Shayba. The scholars mentioned that Sayyidina Hashim radiallahu ta'ala married a woman from Al-Madinah al-Munawwara. He married a woman from the land that we know as Al-Madinah al-Munawwara, from the Khazraj tribe. So Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib radiallahu ta'ala, his mother was a Khazrajiyya radiallahu ta'ala. So we find that this is the link of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the people of Al-Madinah al-Munawwara. So Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, when his mother passed away, he was brought up inside Al-Madinah al-Munawwara. Until one of the brothers of his father, Muttalib, came to Al-Madinah al-Munawwara and asked the people, the maternal side of the family, he asked them that give us Shayba, we will bring him up inside Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. He comes from a distinguished family, and he needs to take on the role of leadership. He needs to be trained inside this, and we need to take him with us. They were reluctant to leave him, his maternal family. But eventually they gave him up, and he was taken to Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. And when people saw him, when people would see some strange person with a person, they might assume that he was their slave. So he became known as Abdul Muttalib, the slave of Muttalib. Muttalib meaning his uncle. That is how he gained that name. And he was a person that the scholars of Sirah write, he used to forbid the people from the evil practices that they were involved in, like the burying of daughters alive. He used to forbid the people from that. He would forbid the people from doing these evils. And he was taken much to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the extent that he would go to the cave known as Ghari Hira. The scholars of Sirah mentioned this. And he would contemplate inside Al-Hira. This was even before the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala was born into this world. Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So we find that this was the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His father, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was known as Abdullah. There is a long story regarding Abdullah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, regarding how his father made a vow. What was this vow relating to? In brief, Zamzam was sealed. It was only discovered when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib radiyallahu ta'ala in a dream that he should dig for Zamzam and dig for the treasure of the Kaaba. And when he was inspired to do so, he began to dig with one of his sons, and he uncovered Zamzam, and water gushed forth. And when this water gushed forth, the Meccans, naturally, water being a scarce resource, all wanted to take have a part inside this. And he didn't have any large number of sons to stand for him. But eventually, alhamdulillah, they agreed, the Meccans, through a series of events that showed that a journey was taken toward Al-Sham. In this journey, the leaders of Makkah were with Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Unfortunately, they ran out of water. And it was only through Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, through the fact that Allah manifested a karama for Abdul Muttalib, an amazing event that broke the norm, that water was discovered. And when they saw that Allah gave him water in the barren surround of the desert, they said, if Allah gave you water in this situation, Allah made you discover the Zamzam, it should stay inside, it should stay with you in your custody. But we will take from it. And he allowed them to do so. So he would be the custodian of it. Thus we find Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib radiallahu ta'ala, who became the custodian of the Kaaba and the custodian of Zamzam. He had a son. He made a vow then to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if Allah gives him 10 sons, then one of the sons he will sacrifice him. Because he felt that he didn't have a large body of sons that could stand up for him if there was any kind of problem or issue. And then the famous story about how he drew lots against his son, like whether he would sacrifice his son or he would give camels, and he ended up having to give 100 camels in the place of Sayyidina Abdullah. This Sayyidina Abdullah was the father of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was married to Sayyidina Aminah bint Wahab radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and her lineage goes through, she is Sayyidina Aminah, the daughter of Wahab, who is the son of Abd al-Manaf. Not the same Abd al-Manaf in the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Note, not the same Abd al-Manaf in the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was the daughter of Wahab, the son of Abd al-Manaf, the son of Zuhra, the son of Kilab, who was the son of Murrah. So we find that the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his father's side and his mother's side, they come together in the individual known as Sayyidina Kilab. Sayyidina Kilab, the son of Murrah. That is where the two lineages come. And the Abd al-Manaf mentioned, Sayyidina Abd al-Manaf mentioned in both lineages, are two different individuals. So know that the actual lineage meets at Sayyidina Kilab, the son of Murrah. So from both sides, the lineages meet at that individual. The lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you want to sense the magnitude of the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the Arabs themselves, in the sixth year of the Hijrah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we will learn, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah took place. And we'll learn about the details of that. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to send messengers out to world leaders. And he sent Sayyidina Dihya bin Khalifa al-Kalbi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Dihya radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, as a messenger on his behalf to the Byzantine Roman emperor, who was known as Heraclius, the emperor of Rome. And at that time he was in Asham, and the letter was taken to him. And there is a long story which I will mention inshallah ta'ala if we have time inside that lesson, regarding the sending of the envoys to the world. One of the questions that Heraclius, who had knowledge of the scriptures of the Christians and the prophecies that were mentioned inside them, he asked regarding the nasab, the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Sufyan, Sayyiduna Abu Sufyan ibn Harb radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, was present, the father of Sayyidina Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He wasn't a Muslim at that time. He wasn't a Muslim in the sixth year of the Hijrah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Later he would embrace Islam in Fath Makkah, eighth year of the Hijrah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was asked about the nasab of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but Heraclius ordered for all the people that are related to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, the one who has claimed prophethood, those that are related to him are present inside this land now, bring them in my court. So they were brought, the people of the Quraysh, amongst them Sayyidina Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Sayyidina Abu Sufyan, they were asked who is the most closest in kinship, in lineage to him. And it was Sayyidina Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Heraclius told him to come forward and told the people to stay behind. And told them that if he lies, make a sign that he is lying. So this is how he would know the person is lying. He asked him about the nasab of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Sayyidina Abu Sufyan later, when he embraced Islam, and mentioned that if it were not for the fact of the shame of lying before the rest of Quraysh, he would have lied about the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they had enmity at that time. Wali'adhu billah, the people of Makkah for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said regarding him, huwa fina dhu nasab, he is of a lofty lineage amongst us, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he mentioned this, the loftiness of the lineage of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would emerge from the best of the best of the best. It is mentioned in the Quranic verse inside Surah Shu'ara that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, and we are seeing you, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you're turning in the people of prostration. You're turning in the loins of the people of prostration, meaning the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was transported from father to father, from the womb of mother to mother, from the womb of a mother to the loins of a father, to the womb of a mother. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continuously being transported by person to person until he emerged into this world from the womb of Sayyidina Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of the scholars mentioned in tafsir that this is one of the tafsir of this verse, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not enter into a body or a womb except there were people of prostration, and the people of prostration are people of tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A further evidence that the scholars mentioned regarding the purity of the lineage of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which causes us to say radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een regarding them, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his mercy upon them, and may Allah be pleased with them, and they are our leaders, sadatuna, our leaders. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is a narration which says, lam azal unqalu min aslabi tahirin ila arhami tahirat, that I have not ceased to be transported from the spines of pure fathers to the wombs of pure mothers. I have not ceased to be transported from the aslab, the spines or the loins of pure fathers, at-tahirin, to the arham, to the wombs of pure mothers, at-tahirat, pure mothers. The scholars say the Quranic verse in Surah Tawbah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ najas. Verily the mushrikun, they are najas. إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ najas. The scholars say it does not necessarily mean that if you touch a disbeliever that there is najas on his hands, because he may have washed his hands, there may be nothing of an impurity on him. Najas from the perspective of aqidah. The aqidah is an aqidah of shirk, association of partners with Allah, kufr, disbelief, and this is filthy. Yep, this is what the filth is. And this is something that we need to, as Muslims, that follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we need to teach Islam, to remove that filth. It is not the physical person, the skin, the body, the bones that we hate. It is beliefs that contradict the beliefs of Islam. That the one who created us, fashioned us out of nothing, the one that gave us everything in this world, that the enjoyments of this world, the things by which we live inside this world, they were all fashioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then a person rejects that. A person rejects that and disbelieves and associates partners with the one who created him. وَلِعَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. That is what we hate. So, إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ najas. If we take the verse of the Quran, then look at this hadith, أَصْلَابِ الطَّاهِرِينَ. They are termed to be tahir, tahirin, pure. And a mushrik is not pure. One who is a polytheist is not pure. The one who associates partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pure in terms of aqidah. How can a polytheist be called tahir? How can they be called tahirin if they were polytheists? Also, arham al-tahirat, al-tahirah, a woman who is tahira is pure. How can they be called tahirat if they worshipped idols? And there are many other evidences. Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi ta'ala wrote something like 9 works showing the evidences regarding that. Regarding the purity of the lineage of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For those who raise the other view, they accept, even those people accept that there were groups of people amongst the Arabian Peninsula who were what we call the Hunafa. Yep. What we call the Hunafa, the Hanafiyun. Yep. Who are the Hunafa? Who are these people? that were Hanif. There were people who clung to the teachings of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, whatever remnants of those teachings remained, and they refused to worship idols alongside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They refused to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they remained upon that. And there were examples at the time of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, before his proclamation of prophethood. Before his proclamation of prophethood, one of the famous companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Zayd, and he is from the Al-Ashwatul Mubashara. Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Zayd radiallahu ta'ala. Who is his father? His father is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nawfal, from the cousins of Sayyidina Umar bin Al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. From the cousins of Sayyidina Umar bin Al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. Who is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nawfal? In brief, radiallahu ta'ala, he lived at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he is known, the historians write regarding, he never worshipped idols. In fact, he will say to the Quraysh that amongst you, I cling to the way of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. I am upon the way of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. I am upon the deen of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. And he would not eat anything that was slaughtered to the idols. He would not worship an idol. He would not bow to an idol. And he would be searching, because he had heard about the scriptures of the Jews and the Christians, and he had encountered Christians, the last Christians that still clung on to some of the teachings of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, that dispersed inside the Arabian Peninsula, inside Ash-Sham. He would go and search them out and find out about these people, but he would not be convinced. He would not be convinced that this is the way. But they would tell him that there is a prophet emerging at the end of time. There will be a prophet emerging at the end of time. And it is said that he journeyed towards what we call Busra. Busra is a city inside Syria, Ash-Sham. He made that journey just at the time when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proclaimed his prophethood at the age of 40 inside Al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. He then heard inside Busra, from the monks inside Busra, that he should journey back to Makkah al-Mukarramah because the Prophet at the end of time is about to emerge. But it is said that he never made it to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, on that journey, he was ambushed and killed. But he intended to go to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and believe in him. And there are some narrations from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he will be raised on the Day of Judgment, and he will be like the worth of a nation, an ummah. And this is because he remained upon tawheed, pure belief, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our answer to those people is, if you can accept that individuals like this existed, despite the people being embroiled in polytheism, you also know that the original beliefs prior to Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i bringing this filth into Makkah al-Mukarramah, the worship of idols, they were upon the tawheed that Sayyidina Ismail al-Islam taught. So what is so far-fetched and what's so difficult for you to accept? The parents of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remained upon tawheed. That they remained upon tawheed. And the belief of the Asha'ira, from the group within the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the two groups in terms of the methodology inside Aqaid, the Asha'ira and the Maturidiyah, it is the understanding of the Asha'ira that the one who lives between the coming of two prophets, so Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam being lifted into the heavens, until the coming and emergence of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's proclaiming a prophethood at the age of 40, what will happen to the people in between that time period? The scholars differed. The Maturidiyah, the scholars say that these people will be questioned regarding the use of the intellect to come to the conclusion that there is one creator. Then they believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will attain salvation in the Akhirah. They will be called to question that you were given intellect and ability to come to the conclusion that there is one creator. In terms of worshipping, they wouldn't know. How do we know how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Revelation, prophet, a prophet or a messenger. There's no other way we will know how to worship the creator. So the scholars, the Asha'ira, the view amongst them is that these people are people of salvation. They call Ahlul Fatrah, the people of the interim time period. That whatever they did, because no prophet was sent to them, no messenger was sent to them, then these people have attained salvation. That is one view. That is one view. Yep, that is one view. So according to that view, the people who lived inside the interim time period attained salvation. According to the other view, they were called to use the intellect and come to the conclusion in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are numerous evidences. The Asha'ira based that upon the verse of the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبَعَثَ رَسُولًا. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ, we were not to punish a group of people, حَتَّى نَبَعَثَ رَسُولًا, until we send a messenger to them. They take that as one of the evidences. That is a broad subject, and we could speak about it for a long time. That is something that we should be very careful regarding, for if a person mentions something about the father or mother of a person, without a doubt a person feels something regarding that. And this is the mother and father of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Moving forward then to the actual time of the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and these are the last few minutes in today's lesson, so we'll just do an introduction to that, and next lesson we'll start off from there, insha'Allah ta'ala. The year of the birth of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is known as the year of the elephant. Why is it called the year of the elephant? The Arabs, they would call years after significant events that occurred inside them. So for the Arabs at the time of the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the significant event that happened in that year for them was that an army came at the head of it, elephants, according to some narration, elephants that came to try and destroy the Kaaba. An army from Yemen led by a king called Abraha. So they named the year after that. We will find in the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam different years. Aam al-Khuzn, the year of grief, in which say that Khadija radiallahu ta'ala left this world. Abu Talib, the uncle of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that would defend him. Though the dominant opinion is that he did not die upon Iman. The dominant opinion, the jumhur, majority opinion of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. That year he passed away, Abu Talib. Also say that Khadija radiallahu ta'ala, that's called Aam al-Khuzn. The year in which all these envoys were sent by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these years are given particular names in accordance to the events that occurred. Aam al-Wufud, the year in which the different groups from the Arabian Peninsula came after Fatih Makkah, the ninth year, different groups came from different parts of the Arabian Peninsula to pledge Islam. Wufud mean waft, meaning delegations, the year of delegations. So different years are given different names according to the significant event that occurred in them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in the year of the elephant, according to some scholars, 55 days before the event of the elephant army, some say 50, before the event of the attempt by Abraha to destroy the Kaaba. And this is inshallah something that we will look at. What we'll mention about Abraha first is that he was one of the kings of Yemen who was Christian, and he had taken some power away from the Christians of Abyssinia. Generally the rulers of the Christians inside Yemen were ruling on behalf of the Christians of Abyssinia. And he felt in his heart a dislike of the Arabs performing pilgrimage inside Makkah al-Mukarramah. But why do the Arabs leave Yemen and why do they go to al-Makkah al-Mukarramah and perform pilgrimage? Why do the people of Arabian Peninsula go there? I will build a cathedral, he said to himself. I will build a cathedral here and I will make people come and leave the Kaaba, and I will make them come to my cathedral and worship in my cathedral. So he built a massive cathedral in the place that we know as the capital of Yemen now, called Sana'a, and that cathedral was called Qulais. And he called people to come and worship and enter into Christianity, and he called people to worship inside that. Now, when the Arabs found out, and the Arabs had ta'zim, honoring and respect for the Kaaba, despite other things that had emerged inside their beliefs, corruption, and their actions, but they had ta'zim, honoring of the Kaaba, and this hurt them. Thus it is said that an individual from amongst the Arabs, according to one narration, went and he defiled that cathedral. He defecated and other things inside that cathedral, and he smeared the cathedral, and this enraged Abraha, and this, it is said, is the cause of him leading an army against al-Makkah al-Mukarramah. And this is 55 or 50 days before the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the destruction of that army is one of what we call the irhasat, amazing events that unfolded before the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An irhas is a thing which breaks the normal order that we see inside the universe, but is not called mu'jiza, is not called miracle, because a miracle manifests after a prophet actually proclaims his prophethood and is known by the people that he is a prophet, and that he's mentioning his prophethood and his messengership. The amazing events that occurred before that are called irhasat. So we can say this is one of the irhasat, one of the amazing events that unfolded, that indicated to the magnitude of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We end there, insha'Allah ta'ala. From next lesson we will continue. Now our aim will be, like I mentioned, just briefly again, is to work through in particular the timeline that is in part 2 of this book, page 63 onwards, going through the major events inside there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to remain throughout this course and take what we have learned
and deliver it to others. May he give us the ability, increase in our love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammadin fil awwalin fil akhirin wa fil mala'il a'la ala yawmiddin. Rabbi zidna ilma alhiqna bis salihin. Allahumma rizqna kamal al-mutaba'ati li rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma rizqna kamal al-mahabbati li rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa adkhilna al-jannata al-firdaws al-a'la min ghayri sabiqati adhab wa la itab wa la fitnah wa la hisab. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa maulana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.